وسيد المرسلين خاتم النبيين سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكم كتابه الكريم وهو أحسن القائلين وأصدق الصادقين، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: نتلو عليك من نبأ موسى وفرعون بالحق لقوم يؤمنون. آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. For the purification of the souls, the enlightenment of the hearts, for the hastening of the reappearance of the awaited Savior, أجر الله تعالى فرجه الشريف, enlighten your souls and the atmosphere with the recitation of salawat upon Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Respected elders, brothers and sisters, salamun alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. In investigating the powerful story of Kalimullah, the one who spoke to the Almighty, Prophet Musa, ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa alayhi afdalu salati wa salam, a number of interesting realization emerges for the person who picks up the Holy Quran. The first realization is the fact that the Quran reminds the believers and those who recite it and follow it of the importance to continuously mention the stories of these individuals. وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مُوسَى وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِدْرِيسِ وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِسْمَاعِيلِ. Allah says, remember these prophets, because these prophets were sent as guidance for mankind, not only their communities. When the Quran says وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ, it means that you and I must continuously refer to these individuals. Remember them. اذكر comes from remembrance. اذكر comes from the realization of their existence and the lessons that we can apply from their lives. That's the first realization. The second is very interesting. And that is, when you look at these stories of these prophets, it is not normally the case that you find the story found in one place in the Quran. It's scattered across different chapters. You ask why? Except for the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, where you find the chapter 12 is Surah Yusuf. Normally the other stories are found in different parts of the Holy Book. Ibrahim alayhi salam in across different chapters, although there is a surah known as Surah Ibrahim. Musa in many chapters, there is no surah called Surah Musa. Isa in several chapters. Dawood and Sulaiman you find across. Nuh, these prophets, there is indeed an idea that the Quran does not specifically say, here is the story of one prophet and that's it. You find the stories in different verses. Why? Have you ever wondered why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed them in different parts of the Quran? Perhaps one reason is the Quran is not a book of storytelling. It's not a book just for stories. It's a book that refers to stories in order for lessons to be learnt. That's a difference, isn't it? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places a story in, for example, Surah Baqarah, He places it within the context, and then there is a moral to be taken from this particular reference. Hence you find, the first reason is this, but the second is what? In order for the believer not to just ignore the idea, but to be able to piece together the stories. Meaning that sometimes when I see a reference to the story of Musa alayhi salam in Surah Baqarah, which is what? Related to the cow. I need to be able to piece that with what is described in chapter 28, Surah Al-Qasas. And I need to be able to bring it together with what is described in chapter 7, Al-I'raf. And I need to completely look at the image or the story when it comes to Surah Taha. Not look at it in isolation. Meaning, it's there to induce reflection and contemplation. It's there to evoke the thinking process of the human being. In addition, what is also interesting, and it's a question that some ask, is there repetition in the Quran as far as stories are concerned? This is an important question. Why? Because some people say 72 times the name Fir'aun is mentioned. 136 times Musa is mentioned. Does Allah refer to these stories time and time again? Is it the same story being repeated? Does the Quran encourage repetition when it comes to the Holy Book? How do we answer this particular question? Of course, you and I know very well that there is no repetition in the Quran, but rather there is emphasis on different segments and dimensions of the story. Meaning, in some parts, the character of Fir'aun is discussed. In other parts, the dimension associated with Bani Israel is referenced. And in third areas, what do we find? In third areas, it is the character of the disobedience of certain individuals, like Qarun. Therefore, when we see Musa's story, alayhi salam, in different areas of the Quran, each part of the Quran focuses on a part or a dimension that is not necessarily discussed in other parts. And there is wisdom in its placing in these areas. Let's examine Surah Al-Qasas in the Holy Quran, chapter 28. The first few verses highlight the beginning of the narrative associated with Moses, peace and blessings be upon him. And you look at the Quran and you compare it to the Old Testament, you find a huge difference, in which case the Quran seeks to exonerate and purify the prophets of God. That is the clear message. Allah has chosen them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has selected them. And they must be presented in good light. It is not that they are just normal human beings who must be criticized and have many shortcomings and false practices. But rather, they are pure human beings selected by the absolute perfect being, sent for the guidance of mankind, and therefore they have to be leaders and role models. And Quran has indeed come out very much different to the Old Testament and the New Testament in this particular way. The realization emerges in Surah Al-Qasas, in chapter 28. After the first two verses is what? Allah says, نَتْلُوا عَلَيْكَ مِنْ نَبَئِ مُوسَى وَفِرْعَوْنَ بِالْحَقِّ. We are revealing to you. What are we revealing to you? We are revealing to you some of the story of Musa and Fir'aun. Men. What really strikes the mind here is that when I read the Quran, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has only included part of the chapter of the story that is relevant. There are some details that are omitted. There are some names that are even mentioned. For example, the name of the wife of Fir'aun, we know her as Asiya because of hadith, but the Quran doesn't mention the name. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not concerned with names. Allah is concerned with outcomes and lessons. That is what is mentioned. Yes? Allah says, نَتْلُوا عَلَيْكَ مِنْ نَبَئِ مُوسَى. From the story of Musa, that which is needed for you to take as lessons in your life, as constitution for your excellence. Number one. Number two, بِالْحَقِّ. It's absolute truth. I tell you, sometimes when you look at certain stories, you question its authenticity. You question, did it really happen? Is this hadith reliable? Is it authentic? Yet the Quran is absolute truth. And when Allah says bilhaq, it means that everything that is false is rejected, and all that is given is correct. لِقَوْمِ يُؤْمِنُونَ. It is for those who are believers, for individuals who accept the truth, who have embraced Iman and are able to take from the story in order to captivate their hearts and to enlighten their souls. Therefore, the more Iman you have, the more the story will resonate with you. Please pay attention to this point. When the Quran says لِقَوْمِ يُؤْمِنُونَ, this lam is known in Arabic as لَامُ التَّعْلِيلِ, meaning it is so that, in order, it is because. When the Quran says this story has been presented for the believers, meaning that if you have weak Iman and weak faith, that particular narrative will not necessarily captivate you, will not necessarily move you. The more connection you have with the Quran, the stronger bond you have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you're able to enjoy the sweetness and the beauty of what is being presented in the Holy Book, especially as far as the narratives are concerned. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has said that when I reveal this Quran, each individual has a capacity. This capacity to understand it is like a vessel. You know, when somebody gives you a cup and says, please fill it with water, you will fill it with water, yes? when you bring this and they pour it, they find this, for example, 500 milliliters. They tell you, why didn't you give me 1 liter of water? You say to them, because you only gave me a cup, which is what? Which is 500 milliliters. I filled it to how much I can. Yes? I was not able to bring you 1 liter of water. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, your hearts are different. Your hearts can expand as far as the capacity to learn and understand the Quran. And therefore, the month of Ramadan is placed so that our hearts expand, so that we understand the Quran more. So that cup that we have does not remain as 500 milliliters. In the month of Ramadan, it can get to hundreds of liters. It's up to you and I. How much I expand the heart will determine how much I understand the Quran. And how much effort I placed on the Quran will determine my success in this holy month. Let's have a look at the story. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala focuses on the birth of two prophets in the Quran. These are whom? One of them is Prophet Isa alayhi salam, and the other is Prophet Musa, peace be upon him. When the emphasis on the birth of an individual is placed, it means that there is nothing wrong with remembering the birth. Because today, some unfortunately Muslims have come forward and said, remembering the birth of saints and holy individuals is bid'ah, it's haram, it's shirk, it's not permissible. You see people coming forward and saying, why do you celebrate the birth of the Holy Prophet? Why do you celebrate the birth of the Imams? That is not something that is found in the Quran and the teachings of the religion of Islam. You reply to them, why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention the births of two prophets? Why does He highlight these in this particular incident if the birth is not something to indeed recognize? Why? Because the Quran tells us not only are these two prophets mentioned as far as their birth is concerned, other prophets have said the date of my birth is a sacred holy date. What do we mean? Prophet Isa alayhi salam says, وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيَّ يَوْمَ وَلِدْتُ وَيَوْمَ أَمُوتُ وَيَوْمَ أُبْعَثُ حَيَّا. Peace be upon me on the day I was born, the day that I die, and the day I will be resurrected. Isa is saying the day I was born is sacred. Yes? Prophet Yahya also says the same thing. Or it is said about him, وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْهِ يَوْمَ وُلِدَ وَيَوْمَ يَمُوتُ وَيَوْمَ يُبْعَثُ حَيَّا. Allah says, peace be upon the day this prophet of God was born. Similarly, Musa alayhi salam's story starts with the birth of Musa alayhi salam. In which way does it start with the birth? Because we are the people of the Quran. We follow the teachings of the Quran. There is nothing wrong with the celebrating of the birth as long as it is the remembrance of Allah, which it is. These are holy individuals that have come to guide us towards Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Therefore, the celebration of their birth is something that is indeed established. And by the way, it happens in places like Egypt, Morocco, Turkey, many Muslim countries, they celebrate the birth of the Holy Prophet. It is only one certain dimension or groups of Muslims that have recently come out for the last few hundred years and have said that this is not part of the teachings of the religion. When you look at the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? It shows my strength. Because these two births of prophets had some extraordinary element about them. How? Prophet Isa alayhi salam was born without a father. And this shows the might and the power of the Almighty. Number one. Number two, Musa's story and his birth also shows that when Allah plans, no one else can change his plan. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa jalla wa ala has ordained will definitely happen. Despite the most tyrant of people wanting to stop an incident from happening. What do we mean? Fir'aun, who? Many have spent trying to investigate who this man is. You know, today you find historical records talking about whether Fir'aun is Ramses II. Yes, Ramses II is a historical figure who lived in Egypt and ruled the Egyptians as well as the children of Israel. And you find the people say, who Fir'aun of Musa is? Many have said it's Ramses II. Others have said no. Some characteristics of Ramses II don't correspond with the Quranic depiction of this individual. And therefore, it is not clear as to who exactly in history he is. Some say it was his son. Ramses II's son is the Fir'aun at the time of Musa. Irrespective, we are not necessarily concerned with his historical identity, but rather what the Quran says about him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that the birth of Musa happened in circumstances which were turbulent in Egypt. In which way? In that this individual, Fir'aun, saw a dream. In his dream, he saw that he was indeed in a place where his throne and his kingdom was being engulfed with fire. And it was being destroyed, yes? When he recognized this, he asked people who are at the time who were interpreters of dreams. He says, I saw this dream. Can you tell me what is the interpretation? They said, a child will be born that will destroy your kingdom. And it's a child from Bani Israel. He made the decision. He said, all the children that are born this year who are male must be killed. Therefore, he went around and he placed spies in the houses of the women who are pregnant. And he said, once the child is born, kill the child. Don't leave any child alive. They came to Fir'aun and said to him, we have a problem. He said, what is it? He said, when we are killing these males, these young babies, boys, we will not have in the future slaves to do what we want them to. All of them will be girls. How do we solve this problem? Yes. Fir'aun then decided, fair enough, 1 year we kill all the infant babies who are boys. In another year we keep them. Yes. The year that the Musa's brother Harun was born was the year that Musa decided to keep the babies who are boys. But the year of Musa's birth was the year that children were being slaughtered and the babies were being killed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concealed the pregnancy of Musa's mother, just how he concealed the pregnancy of the mother of the awaited Savior, Sahib al-Asr wal-Zaman, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-Sharif. Indeed, who will be born and he will be, the pregnancy was concealed, just like the pregnancy. But when for the baby in Surah Taha says, you, they are attracted to you, they want to protect you, they want to defend you. Musa alayhi salam, when he was born, this lady did not wish to do anything to him. And therefore, what did she decide? She decided to remain silent. She decided to be quiet and not say anything to the authorities regarding the birth of this child. Yes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed this mahabba on the heart of this lady. One lesson that can emerge from here is what? When Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wants to, He will make people follow an individual and love an individual and respect an individual despite the plans and the plots of others. People may go out there wishing to do what they want, but when the Almighty wants to change the heart, ya muqallib al qulub wal absar, He will change the hearts of people. Yes. Musa is born. His mother is told in the Quran. Yes. His mother is told, wa awhayna ila ummi Musa an ardi'i. The verses are there for you to have a look at in order that we live with the Quran, because we have a hadith of the sixth Imam, Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad and as-Sadiq salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. When he was asked, should we, if we have memorized the verses in the Quran, should we recite it or should we look at the holy book? He says, no, I am paraphrasing. He says, look at the holy book even though you have memorized the verses. Why? Because that is purification for your eyes. When you look at the Quran, yes, that is indeed also something which blesses your eyes when you're looking at the holy words. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَرْضَعِيهِ. We reveal to the mother of Musa. How did he reveal? Do non-prophets get revelation and wahi? Yes. Wahi comes in one of three ways. Either placement in the heart, or through a veil. Veil means something that Allah creates that what is communicating with the human being through the words of Allah, such as what happened to Musa, or through a messenger such as Jibra'il alayhi salam, an archangel of Allah which communicated and got this message across. This wahi can be received by non-prophets. And this is called ilham, intuition. It's placed in the hearts of people, anyone. Yes. Sometimes you and I want guidance from Allah, and that is placed in our hearts by the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says to the mother of Musa, suckle him, breastfeed him. First lesson, breastfeeding is recommended in the religion of Islam. Question, why does Allah say to the mother of Musa, breastfeed? He could have said immediately the verse, place him in the casket. What the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to say is, despite the presence of alternatives, breastfeeding is good. Breastfeeding, as far as our mothers, as far as our wives are concerned, for our children is a good thing. In this day and age, due to the demand of pressures of work, you have people who are less and less going towards this direction. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I provided the females with milk, utilize it because it's full of nourishment. It increases the bond with the child, but is also spiritually uplifting. Why? When the Quran says arḍi'i, Quran does not only talk about physical nourishment, it talks about spiritual too. It is good for the soul when the mother is breastfeeding the child. Yes? Then the Quran says, فَإِذَا خِفْتِ عَلَيْهِ فَأَلْقِيهِ فِي الْيَمْ. When you are fearful about him, then throw him in the river. Question. Why does Allah says throw him? In Arabic, alqihi means throw. It doesn't mean place him. Please pay attention to how certain parts of the Quran are so delicate. Allah says, you have this baby, throw the baby in the river. Don't place the baby in the river. Why? Why the Quran says alqihi, not dha'hu, for example? Yes? Why? There is a beautiful spiritual concept which is derived from this particular verse. That is indeed something that we alluded today in Khutbatul Jumu'ah, which is what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you and I to give up that which we desire and to rid ourselves from it. And this is part of the process known as disconnection and connection. What does that mean? Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wants us to disconnect from that which distracts us from Him and connect with the Divine. Yes. When it comes to, for example, Yusuf alayhi salam, Yusuf alayhi salam, there was the what? There was the wife of the Aziz. Yusuf had that particular what? Opportunity, God forbid, to commit that, although he was ma'soom. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he disconnected and connected with Allah. He disconnected with materialism and connected with the absolute perfect being, the Almighty Jalla wa Ala. That is why Salatul Layl, it's so beautiful and highly recommended within the religion of Islam. Allah says in the Quran, you would not be able to know the extensive rewards of Salatul Layl. Disconnect from the sleep and speak to Allah and see the difference. Allama Tabatabai, Allahu Ta'ala Maqamah, the author of Al-Mizan, his teacher Sayyid Ali Qadi Tabatabai, in Najaf al-Ashraf, he says, I asked him, he was one of the Urafa, one of the mystics. He said, I asked him, what should I do to attain excellence in this dunya? Alayka bi salatil layl, he responded. Perform salatul layl, namaz ashab, yes? He said, I asked him, how do I achieve excellence in akhirah? He said, my teacher told me, alayka bi salatil layl. Perform Salatul Layl, yes. And the month of Ramadan is a wonderful opportunity to start Salatul Layl, yes. Sometimes we wake up for Fajr, or before Fajr for Suhoor, yes. We sometimes stay up the whole night. And this is a golden opportunity to pray these rak'ats, which are highly recommended. The sixth Imam says, لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ لَمْ يُصَلِّي صَلَاةُ اللَّيْلِ. This is found in Bihar al-Anwar. Anyone who does not perform Salatul Layl is not indeed one of us. This process is beautiful. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, why should you give away that which you desire? Because in that there is refinement of the soul for you and excellence as far as your status is concerned. لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. You will not attain righteousness until you give that which you desire the most. Allah says, give it away and see the difference. for you and I to give up the eating and drinking in the month of Ramadan is a spiritual assault course that brings us into high levels of understanding and cognizance and ma'rifah. Here the Quran tells us, Allah says to Musa's mother, give up your son. This is an opportunity for you to attain brilliance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned her in the Quran and has selected her because of her willingness to do this, isn't it? Her willingness to go with what she was somehow communicated in her hearts. My dear brothers and sisters, you and I are granted these opportunities to give up that which we desire. Sometimes we take it and sometimes we don't. When somebody comes to us and says to us, please help me, genuinely, I am in need. I am in need, can you please give me some charity? This is Allah's opportunity and a chance for us, that He has presented for us, to give up that which we need. And Allah says, you give it up and I will help you in your life. Yes. And I will assist you in your needs. Yes. I remember one of the ulama here in the United States, in the Western Coast, told me the story last year. He said there was a brother, a Shia brother, who had gone to Hajj. Yes. He was, mashallah, one of the wealthiest in the Western Coast of America. Yes. He had gone to Hajj, and when he returned from the blessed pilgrimage, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us tawfiq to perform the Hajj this year. I tell you, the month of Ramadan is the time, and especially the nights of Qadr, in which the list of the people going to Hajj will be written. This is the time, the month in which we ask Allah, and indeed us, our names to be included in this list. He said, we are building a youth center, a big Shia center in the Western Coast. We needed several million dollars. And we knew that he was a man who was able to help us. He had the wealth to be able to help us. So after coming back from Hajj, you know, we said he's coming back from Hajj, his heart is softer, he has come pure, yes. This is a good opportunity. We ask him for donation. It was clever also to go at that time. Yes. So they went. This Sayyid, this Mawlana said, I went with a friend of mine. We went to his office. MashaAllah, his office was grand. We went inside, he welcomed us. We sat down. We said to him, brother, may Allah accept your Hajj. تقبل الله أعمالكم حج مبرور وسعي مشكور وعمل مقبول. Here is our project. This is one of the biggest centers in the Western Coast of America. We need several million dollars. How much can you help us? The Sayyid said, I looked at him, this rich Shia brother looked at me and said, very well, I will help you inshallah. He said, I was very happy. He went away, he came back after a while with an envelope. When he gave the envelope to us, my friend who took it said the envelope was very light. You know, sometimes you know how much it is by the weight of the envelope. So he said, I thought maybe it's a check. There must be a check. That is the only way in which I can gather that he must have helped us. He said, this friend of mine could not wait until we leave the office in order to find out how much donation we have obtained for our center. We went, he said, let me go to the restroom. He went to the restroom to check how much it is in the envelope. He went to the restroom, he opened and he found inside the envelope $114. How much? 114. Subhanallah. Sometimes we use numbers for our own benefit. As we think it's 114. Yes, verses in the Quran, for example, is a good thing. And therefore, 114, when it's surahs in the Quran, is a good thing. Therefore, I place this number of dollars. So he placed it in the envelope and he came out. He was very disappointed. He said, my friend was very upset. When the brother went to get some tea, he looked at me and said, can you believe, Maulana, it's only $114. MashaAllah, he's wealthy, he's a millionaire, he has only given us 114. I said to him, duck, went because to the ghusl, to do that. I said, subhanAllah, Allah gave him a chance, moment, to leave sadaqa jariya. This is a moment to, now your sons don't want to have anything to do with you because they're disputing about the wealth. He has gone and there is no one even to look after his body. What has happened to the millions that he had? Yes. What has happened to the properties that he had? Yes. Allah Jalla wa Ala sends us signals and opportunities in our lives. Take it. If you don't take it, it may not come back. Yes. Musa's mother had this opportunity. Allah says to her, place him in the Yam. Yam is a larger river. It's quite a large river. وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي. What is this khawf and hazan? Khawf means from Fir'aun's army or Fir'aun himself to harm her son Musa. And hazan, sadness from being separated. Verse 1, number 2, chapter 28 of the Quran. Tense is used in this verse. Second, the Al-Qih. Suckle him and throw him. There are two prohibitions. لا تخافي. The Quran tells us twice. The Quran here tells her not to go إليك of the messengers. And there are two indeed thankful verse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in this regard. When Allah is with us, we are not did not know what to do. One narration tells us, seeking the baby, they heard that there is a baby born in this house, in her, in the oven. The mother, subhanahu wa ta'ala, saved him. Don't be surprised. The one who saved him, placed him in a small casket, it by a carpenter. She asked the carpenter to find out there is a baby. He went to, and he asked Fir'aun. Or he wanted to tell Fir'aun. He knocked on the door of the palace. They opened the door. They said, can we help you? He said, Fir'aun. They said, very well. What is it? He says, very important. I cannot say anyone else. So they took him towards the Pharaoh. He was not able to say anything. And his mouth. He struggled. Not able to speak again. Then he said to the soldiers, no. Now I am able to speak. I beg you, take me back to the. They took him back. Pharaoh said, you better speak this time. Subhanahu wa ta'ala is what? Is preventing. Therefore, this was something that he recognized. When Musa alayhi salam was placed in the river, yes, he was placed within the protection of Allah. And this is what is important. The lesson to be learned here is of that tawakkul and dependency on Allah is not only in the heart and through the tongue. It must be supplemented with actions. Meaning what? Musa's mother did not say, Ya Allah, protect him. Ya Allah, I leave him in your protection. Yes? She also placed him in somewhere where he will be protected. Indeed, that is Ali wa sallam. Protected. Don't just leave the camel there and say, yes, Allah will protect it. Yes, it must be supported with action. Sometimes we don't understand. Meaning what? If today someone was to come to tell us, in order to just from, let me give you examples of modern day life. In fiqh and jurisprudence, on a daily basis sometimes, people like me are asked questions, why does Allah want us to do this? Why, for example, you and I are not permitted to sit in a table where there is alcohol that is consumed? They say, brother, I understand we're not supposed to have alcohol. But to sit in a table where alcohol is consumed is very difficult to explain to my non-Muslim friends. I can't understand it. Why is Allah? Today I had a question from someone. Alhamdulillah, the blessings of WhatsApp, 24-hour questions. This question came. He said, I have in the United Kingdom, he said, some colleague at mine at work is asking him about fasting. And he's saying the females, when they go through the time of the month menstruation, they're not supposed to fast. Yes? But after the month of Ramadan, they must repay the fast. They must do the qadha. Yes? He asked me, why do they have to do the qadha of fasting but not of salah? Yes. They don't have to pay up the salah during the year and in the month of Ramadan when they don't pray for that period of time, yes? Why is it that they have to do it for the fast, but not for the prayers? Is it because fasting is more important? He was saying this, praying, because do I have to pray for 5 months, but they have to repay there? I said to him, no problem. I'll give you explanation why Fajr is 2 and Dhuhr is 4. He said, I don't know. I don't have the explanation. You see, the Quran tells us the fundamental element of a believer is what? الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. You must believe in the unseen. Today in the world of information influx, overload, everything is here, yes? You Google, you want to find out everything and you can. Some people want to know why. No problem. For aqidah, let's investigate. Yes. For fiqh, you can investigate. But there is a point. There may be a hadith. There may be a derivation process. Yes? But not every ruling we have an explanation for. Not every incident we can explain. Sometimes logically it's possible, but sometimes it's not. When I am told in fiqh that I am not able to sit in the table where there is alcohol that is consumed, I may not be convinced in the heart, but this is a test for me. This is an examination of the strength of my willingness to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes? I may not be able to fully explain it to others, but I must be proud of my teachings. And hence you recognize this moral has to be taken from the incident of the mother of Musa. But what is crucial to find out here is the story of Musa is significant because it highlights the role of women. How many times have we thought about that? The story begins with the mother of Musa, then it continues with the sister of Musa, as well as the wife of Fir'aun. The key characters at the beginning of the story are all female. Yes? Highlighting that Allah is on. They are praised in the Holy Quran. And that's why we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala references them. And inshaAllah ta'ala, we will continue this discussion as we go forward in this chapter and other chapters with the barakah of salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.